let's take a look at the bionase. And the bionase is a device that is purported to help with things like hay fever and other nasal allergies. And the idea is that you have this probe that you stick up your nose, and it irradiates it with red light of a specific wavelength. Now, the red light therapy has been around for a long time. In the earliest days, when only 660 nanometer LEDs were available, this deep red ones, they were the only ones that are available in really high output. Conveniently, the light therapy industry just used those ones because, you know, it was what was available. And they said that the 660 nanometer was the magic wavelength. And now that we've got much brighter shades of red, like in this case, they're touting the 630 nanometer wavelength, and it's harder to get the 660 nanometer ones. Now, apparently, the correct wavelength is 630 nanometers. And let's take a look at the listing first. It's a generic listing. This price of these ranges dramatically from about, in American dollars, from about $5.50 up to $60, with the $60 one saying, this is the original one from Israel, all the others are copies. And that probably is the case, because I get the feeling this is not terribly complex inside. Many of these companies, I'll read its description. One piece nose therapy, healthcare, bionase, rhinitis, sinusitis, and yeah, it covers just most things. Oh, and it says massage device cure. It doesn't really massage, not unless you ram it in and out your nose. What was I going to say there? I was going to say something else. Some of them go further and they claim that it pulses LEDs at specific frequencies. And the only way to find that out is to actually check if it is actually doing that. So the battery cover comes off. And there's a couple of spring contacts inside. It takes a, looks around for a PP3 battery. Not very well marked. Very hard to see the markings in that because they're just embossed into the plastic. Don't know what happens if you put it the wrong way around. It may die. It might not. Let's put this in the right way. I almost found out the hard way if it dies when you put the battery in the wrong way around. I hope it would have protection. And then you plug the probes into the end and you push the button. And they light up red. Now, are they pulse width modulator? I'm just going to shake them. I'm not seeing any frequency modulation to that, so I'm guessing, and they're not even the same brightness. Hold on, let's bring that back in and point. No, one is much brighter than the other. Okay. Now, I'm guessing the circuitry in this is as simple. It could be just a simple timer. It's got a little green LED there. Ah, didn't know that. Oh, look at that. When you unplug it, the green LED starts flashing. Right, that's interesting. I thought, when you push the button to turn it on, it doesn't turn back off again. You push the button, it's a timer. I was thinking originally that these three connections in this jack were for, I'm going to bring a meter in now. Continued is good enough. So let's check if that is that negative and that positive. The LEDs have just lit up. It's showing the drop across the LEDs. I wonder if they're just in parallel. The tip appears to be negative and the ring appears to be positive. And I'm guessing the other connection, let's put it to resistance. Let's put it to a high resistance and see if there's just a resistor between the other connections to show when it's present. Or it might just be detecting something being plugged into the jack. Or it might just not be using that connection at all. I think it's just used a standard connector. I don't think there's anything connected to the middle connection at all. Okay. So let's make our guesses. What's inside this unit before I spudge it home? Because I don't see any screws. It might be glued shut. If it is, it's going to be violent. I'm guessing, originally I would have thought maybe it was a very simple timer circuit, like a 555 just running for X amount of time. You know, when you push the button, it might charge a capacitor, and then when that capacitor drains down below a threshold, it goes off. But now I see that it detects the missing LED and it starts flashing. I'm wondering if this is a little 8-pin generic chip in here. Right, there's only one way to find out, and that's to open it. So let's get the spudger into it. Well, that's reassuringly easy. Oh, that's very reassuringly easy to open. I've said that before and then suddenly it's stopped opening. Oh, there we go. Oh, pride of place in the middle is the little 8-pin chip. I'm guessing that might be a voltage regulator. There's probably not going to be a number on the chip. The chip has no number. There's a surprise. Oh, the what I thought was the regulator is marked 7144-1. Power's come in. There is a protection diode. The output is going up here. It's got a cup. It's got three connections going over to there. It's got the little button here. It's got the LED and a little resistor for the LED. The button is just going between the, which is connection is it? I think that's a positive rail, and the chip. Okay. Right, let's take a look. I'll reverse engineer that in a moment. I'll doodle it down. But let's take a look at the probe. Get the feeling these aren't going to come out easily. Oh, I was wrong. Oh. Oh, these bits just pull off. Maybe that's a hygiene thing. Oh, and it's just two surface mount LEDs in the end. It literally is just two surface mount LEDs sort of sat into the end of this plastic form. I wonder if they're moulded in or the leads are going down through the middle. I may just open one and find out. Right, I'm going to pause while I just doodle that down and I'll be back in a moment. Job done, and it really didn't take that long at all because it's a very simple construction. It's just optimised for mass production. The circuitry is super basic, relying heavily on really just the software and this little chip here, which is most likely just a generic microcontroller. So all the circuitry, active circuitry on board, we've got the protection diode, we've got the voltage regulator, which is at 71441, which is a 4.4 volt regulator. We've got the chip itself, a resistor for the LEDs, a resistor for the green LED, and that's more or less it. There's a pull-down resistor here. Let's take a look at the schematic. So it starts off, the 9-volt battery is connected here and it goes via diode, so there is polarity protection. There's a initial filtering capacitor, there's the voltage regulator that regulates it from whatever voltage is going into a stable 4.4 volts. And then there's two more smooth capacitors. One's larger than the other, so I guess, and I tried measuring them, but you know, you can't really measure capacitors in circuit easily because other circuit elements will tend to drag that down. But I got roughly 6 microfarads. I don't know if that's accurate. It might be 6.8 microfarad capacitors. It might have been closer. It might have been a mile off. But I'm guessing that the other one, the smaller capacitor, is probably a 100 nanofarad decoupling capacitor, which is really common. So that's the power supply section. It's just basically power in some decoupling capacitors and a regulator for the 4.4 volts. Mystery chip here, mystery, has, it's connected to the rails, 4.4 volts, 0 volts. The green LED that indicates whether it's on or the timing cycle's on or if the thing's not plugged in by flashing, it's disconnected with a 1K resistor, which is quite a high value resistor for, because the LED itself, it looks like a gallium phosphide LED, one of the simpler, lower intensity ones, and they benefit from a slightly higher intensity, but you know, it's visible, so 1K is fine. When you push the button, it pulls one of the input pins down to the 0-volt rail, so that's probably got an internal high pull-up resistor to detect when that button's pressed. On the output side of it, the nasal probe, I'll just write what that is, it's the nasal probe. There we go, makes it look more sophisticated. It's quite interesting in the sense that there is a significant circuit modification. It looks like they've originally had two resistors in parallel on two separate pins, but one has been disabled, so they've just got one 120 ohm resistor. Again, that's not going to light those LEDs at much current. They were probably wanting a higher current by basically powering the LEDs one per output, just so they could really push the current up, but that didn't happen, so they've kind of compromised there. And the only reason I can think of that, they've actually physically cut a track. They have drilled the hole right through the middle of the track, whereas these two resistor positions were supposed to be connected to the chip output. They've changed that. They've cut the track, and then they've kind of, instead of putting a resistor here, they've blobbed across and put a resistor there. It's very odd. I wonder if they had a conflict in the software. I wonder if they ended up with one going high and one going low. Sudden current draw maybe caused problems, or if one was left high and one was left low, when they're writing the software, it would have drained the battery flat very quickly because it would have been basically shunting these resistors directly across a high and low output of the microcontroller. I'm not sure. But that one resistor drives the two LEDs in parallel. They're interesting the way they're mounted. It's quite clever the way they're mounted. I shall show you that afterwards. For the button, the switch in here that is these two contacts here, these two here, when you insert the probe, it opens those contacts. If the probe's not there, they're shorted. Let me demonstrate that right now with a suitable meter, which isn't continuity. So at the moment, they're shorted. If I plug this in, they'll either be open or I'll get a diode. They're open. Okay. The diode would be the, and if I, depending on the polarity, the diode would potentially be one of the diodes inside the protection circuit inside the chip itself and the pins. I'm just dropping everything now. Excellent. So when that switch, when it's the unit is unplugged, that switch is closed, and the nasal probe is unplugged, and that means it pulls this pin here up to the 4.4 volt rail. But if you plug it in, it disconnects that, and then it's pulled down by the 330k resistor, which is quite a high value, but there's a reason for that. If you left it with the probes unplugged and that switch was closed, then basically that 330k resistor is continually across the 4.4 volt and 0 volt rail, and it passes a very small current. So they've chosen a high value resistor there deliberately so it doesn't drain the battery flat quickly. And that's fundamentally it. But here's the interesting bit. The construction of the probes is interesting. They've got these sort of hard plastic bits that the caps then go over, the changeable nasal caps that just kind of press fit. Yes, they sort of click fit. So what they've got here is they've got an internal core like this, and it's got a square recess in the top and then a sort of core down the middle. And they've brought the cable in, just standard sort of headphone cable with the loose, the sort of lacquered copper strands. And the cable comes in, and then the two strands are sort of like, they're tinned at the end to break the insulation, then they're folded over. So you get two strands coming out and folding over the top. And then they quite literally ram an LED into that, and the side contacts, sort of gullwing, they're not really gullwing contacts, the side contacts of the surface mount chip that just fold underneath, they make contact with the exposed area of that copper, and that's what makes the connection, and then they presumably just crop them off once they've done that connection. And these hard plastic bits look as though, I don't think they're push fit into the thing, I think they're actually, I think by the look of it, they've got these sort of probes with the wires pre-terminated, but not actually the LEDs put in yet, I'm guessing. And then they mould it into this sort of nasal restraint type system that then couples to the other one. So it's sort of injection moulded in situ. And that's a hard plastic, the stuff up here, whereas this is a sort of chewier plastic. And both the cables come back and they're just connected between the positive to the ring and the negative to the tip in this instance. So very, very simple construction, makes it easier for them to make. And the circuitry is just really textbook. It's what you'd expect of a circuit like this. It's all it has to be. It's fairly minimalist. Whether it works or not is entirely up to you. Oh, there's another thing here. Something that I didn't notice when I brute force took this apart. When I just ripped this apart, I didn't realise there was actually a concealed screw in it. I only discovered that afterwards. And the screw is put in, and then this thing clips in a very much a one-way trip. Once that's in, you can't get it back out again. That's presumably to hide the secret circuitry inside. And the only way I could get that out was to actually pinch it from the inside. I don't think you could. Maybe you could squeeze with a suitable tool. You could basically put it in and sort of lever in like that to get it out. But it's not designed for the layman to get out. And therefore, theoretically, the case isn't going to come apart. Unless, of course, a bear pulls it apart. In which case, everything just breaks explosively. Which is what happened here. Not the screws very long in the first place. It wasn't really making much of an effort. But yes, that's what's inside your optical nasal, optical nasal exposure unit. And as I say, if you do some research online, you'll see this therapy, red light therapy, has been going back a long way, but no conclusive evidence as to whether it actually does work. So just for completeness, let's make our own nasal radiator from scratch. So we'll start off with a USB supply because it's really convenient. It's a nice, handy 5-volt supply. So we get the plus 5 volts and we've got 0 volts. And all we're going to do is connect two LEDs across those and we're going to run them at full whack. We're going to run them at 20 milliamps. So to do that, I'm going to be using 150 ohm resistors and I shall explain that. So these are 150 ohm resistors, both of them. I could have written that in the middle, and that would have been both of them, but there we had two separate 150 ohm resistors, one per LED, and the way I worked those out is 5 volts minus roughly about 2 volts, the LED, gives 3 volts to drop. And that's across the resistor. R equals the voltage to drop over the current desired, and that gives 3 volts divided by 0.02, which is 20 milliamps, and that gives 150 ohms. So that's the choice. I'm going to use a generic Poundland USB lead. I'm going to use two very standard red LEDs. I'm going to use the straw hat style LEDs, just because I have them. And if you go online and these days, if you buy the highest output red ones you can get, then they will invariably be the sort of the warmer wavelengths because they're closer to the eye's spectral, peak spectral sensitivity, so they look the brightest. So ultimately, it doesn't matter the shade of red, really. I know they're saying like, oh, it must be 630 nanometer, but then again, they used to say it was 660 nanometer. Ultimately, they're just using what's the most red available LED, but nowadays, it is most likely to be in the 630 to 640 nanometer range. So that's the ones we'll be using. And the first thing I'm going to do, I'm going to put the resistors on the negative lead. And the reason for that is simply because the positive lead is slightly longer. So I'm going to crop this off about 1/4 inch, 6 millimeters from the end of the LED on the negative lead. Then I'm going to bring over the helping hands here, which are quite helpful in this instance. And I'm going to crop one of the resistor leads to about, say, 3 millimeters-ish, which is about 1/8 of an inch. And I'm going to tin it. And I'm going to tin, I could actually just flow them together if I can actually hold them steady enough for doing that. It's a bit of a nuisance when you've got the other lead in the way, so that might not work. No, tell you what, let's just tin them, flow some solder onto them, and then I'll place that on and I'll reflow it. Still pretty awkward with that other lead in the vicinity, but that's just how it is. If I'd thought of this, I would have bent it out of the way, but I didn't, not to worry. So that's flowed on. That's us got the resistor soldered onto that LED. Let's get the other one. I may just put this round the other way. It might be a little bit easier for access. Crop the resistor down. I'll actually crop it down. It doesn't really matter which way around you put the resistor. It's a non-polarized component. So just for the sake of it, I shall put it round the other way. So I'm going to flow some solder onto that. Big blob of solder, actually. That was a bit over-generous, partly because the tip of the iron needs wiped. Too much solder. Let's reflow that with fresh solder. Hold it there, and then just reflow them together. And that should be them. I think that's them. Did that feel right? That's good enough. That's perfect. Now what I'm going to do, I'm going to part the leads slightly. And I'm going to slip some heat shrink sleeving over them. I'm going to use super thin sleeving for the lead that doesn't have the resistor on it. Is that the thinnest I've got? Yes, it is. It's super thin sleeving. I'm going to cut it so it's just shy of the end of the lead. Clear sleeving, which makes it so much harder for you guys to see. And let's crop this to about the same length. I could have done that there. Oh, I should do it in front of the camera. That's probably helpful. And we'll slip that over. And then I shall heat shrink these on. So let's get the other one done first. Did you hear the voice soften there? That's because I just got into the project. This is what happens. When I get into it, everything just goes a little bit softer because I'm kind of enjoying myself making stuff. Making stuff is good. You should make stuff. It's just the best. Okay, it's a red nasal irradiator, but you know what? It's still making something. So that slips over there, slips over the resistor, slightly wider sleeving for that. Let's grip these in a pair of long-nose pliers. Not too hard. Bring down my little trusty hot air gun. And shrink those on. I have a sneaky feeling that I have I have lowered the temperature slightly in this. It's just taking a wee bit longer to shrink, but that's okay. That looks pretty good, and the reason for the heat shrink sleeving is so you don't, you're going to stick this up your nose, theoretically, or elsewhere. Oh. So you don't want any sort of, like, bare metal up there. It may only be low voltage DC, but that still has an effect on moist tissue. It causes damage to skin cells if you pass DC current through them. And given that one of the listings for this said that the treatment time is 15 minutes, like you stick that thing up your nose for 15 minutes, which doesn't sound like a good idea, then, you know, you don't want stuff like this up too long. Now, the question is, could I then put another bit of heat shrink over like this? That's kind of fitting. And that would then, it's just going to fill up the mucus, isn't it? Ugh. It's probably a bad idea. I'm already regretting this, and yet here I am just bludgeoning on. Right, okay, let's just bludgeon on anyway and do this. I'm using slightly undersized heat shrink. I'm going to have to just do that wee trick of just stretching it slightly with the long nose pliers. And this will seal the end off so that stuff doesn't get in, theoretically, or it will just trap the stuff. One of the two. So let's get this heat gun down again and heat shrink that. Heat shrink, it's not that expensive. It's good having a good selection of sizes to fit every task you might find because it is very useful stuff. You don't need a hot air gun to shrink it down. You can use, as other people have said, you can use the tip of an iron or the side of an iron. You can rub the side of an iron on it and it will shrink it down. Or you can use a lighter, although that's a bit, you know, it's a bit touch and go. It really is sort of delicate, the timing. So now what I'm going to do, now I've got these, is I'm going to crop the leads the same length. And I'm going to solder the two negative and the two positive together. I'm going to splay them apart for this just to make this easier. And keep in mind that if you are supposed to stick this up your nose, then you kind of want some space. So I'm keeping these leads as long as possible. So let's, this is where I burn myself, not to worry. It's just the easiest way to do it. Pinch those together like that, and then flow some solder onto them. Keeping in mind, I'm going to have to put another connection on as well. So this is probably a terrible idea. Yes, it is, because they're going to ping apart later on when I reheat them. Oh well, that's what happens. So on that basis, maybe I should get the third connection onto that, which is the USB lead. So this is from Poundland, as usual. A typical Poundland being a sort of British dollar store. And this is a common, you know, they're available in a wide range of colours, including pink, which I've run out of. I should have looked for that today. And I'm just going to cut the iPhone charging terminal off lead, and I'm going to nibble around this delicately, probably chopping all the wires inside as I do so. When I strip like that, I tend to sort of pull it, almost like just nip at it with the pliers, just to, the snips, just to try and weaken it all the way around. The green and white are the data, they're not needed. The pink and the black should be positive and negative. I often say you should always check the polarity here, but in this instance I'm not going to bother, just because, well, just because. I'm just, every other one has been correct from Poundland, I think. So let's just pretend this one might be correct. Should I check it? Nah. So let's tin these leads as well. I wonder why they chose pastel colours, grey for the negative and pink for the positive. Is it actually just saving on pigment? Now, another thing about these, when you heat them up, the plastic tends to shrivel back in them a wee bit. So the two leads I've sold together already are the positives, so let's add this one into the mix. Oh, that went surprisingly well, said Clive with surprise. And let's get the other leads of the nasal probe. And we'll pinch them together. Get the negative lead there. Try and get them all together. This is going to be the footery bit. It's going to try and crush them onto one small space. And then try and hold them in place while heating it up to thermonuclear temperatures to melt the solder. So let's get the solder on that. That kind of worked. I actually managed to get them all accidentally. That's quite good. Is it going to be strong? Who knows? So now I'm going to splay these apart so they can go one up each nostril. And let's put another bit of heat shrink on here. So what's going to fit here? I'm just going to put it up the way so the leads then sort of gets a bit of strain relief. Technically speaking, I could have soldered the leads on this end and then slid a bit of heat shrink up, but I didn't. So is this going to fit? This is pretty close call. Nah, you know what? I'll use the next size up, which is this one. This might actually be too big. I think I should have made a bit more effort there, but I didn't. So this would definitely be easier if I'd actually put the heat shrink on over these leads. Yeah, because then it would have opened wider for nostril insertion. I may actually stick this up my nose afterwards. And we want to put it up just beyond the outer insulation of the supply cable, and then heat shrink that again. And then theoretically, if I've got the polarity right here, if the polarity of the cable's right, this should light up red when I plug it into a USB port. So, here we go. Here, we'll just bend it for ready for nostril insertion. So there's our nostril probe. Find a USB power supply. Let's use this one since it comes to hand. Oh yes, high power nasal probes. So will I stick them up my nose right now? Hold on, I'll tell you what they're like. I'm just sticking it up my nose now. It feels like LEDs stuck up my nose. Noting that the website, I'll just pull this out, I'll make it sure it's clear of mucus so I don't alienate you all. One of the web pages said it's a 15 minute treatment with that other thing, the probes that go up your nose, and I was thinking 15 minutes every day is a very long time. That would be really annoying. And technically speaking, if you've got hay fever, then stuffing your fingers up your nose for 15 minutes would also probably have some beneficial effect in terms of momentary relief from that. But yeah, that's that. Other things you could do with this, since it's nice and bright, and since Halloween's coming up. This would be quite nice as Halloween eyes. Would it be quite nice as Halloween eyes? Oh, I think it would. Spooky eyes. So that's how to make yourself a red nasal hay fever probe type thing.